Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
So we were discussing about electronic injection systems, and as I mentioned to you, there are two types. One is the common rail direct injection system, and the other one is unit injector system. So electronic injectors are mechanically pressurized, but the timing of injection, start of injection, end of injection, this is controlled by a microprocessor. So it is controlled electronically, and obviously there are many integrated circuit involved. Then there is a current requirement, heavy current requirement for operating the solenoid. So there are many relays are involved. Okay, so when you say electronic control, that means the injection timing, the injection duration, and the metering. This is controlled by ECM, electronic control module, or which is also called electronic control unit, or sometimes it is also called electronic governor. So these are all interchangeable terms. So these are the three parameters which are controlled by the ECU. So electronic ignition and fuel injection is a logical step. Since you know ECU has a microprocessor and they have quite a powerful computing power inside, and this computing power is quite cheap. If you look at the cost of ECU today, I think it is within like $50 to $100 you can get a very powerful microprocessor with all the relays and all other components. So this with the reducing cost of computing power and the reducing size has really revolutionized the IC engine because of the introduction of the ECUs. So the injection systems follow the following functions. One is they time the fuel delivery. At what time the start of injection will happen, they control that. And then pressurize the fuel for combustion. So the pressure, fuel pressure, is also controlled by the ECU. And then finally, they atomize and distribute the fuel in the combustion chamber, and this is done by the nozzle, high pressure nozzle that you have. So if you look at the, there could be many types, you know. For example, there could be individual pumps and individual nozzles. So that means for every cylinder, there is a pump and there is a nozzle. Okay, so this is basically nothing but unit injector system. In unit injector system, pump and nozzle both are in the same housing. Okay, so you have mechanical drive coming all the way to the injector, and in fact the pump, and pump then pressurizes, and there is no high pressure line here because pump and injector both are housed in same body. Okay, then you could have pumps in a common housing, okay, but they are individual nozzles. And this pump, for example, if it is a six cylinder engine, there will be six individual pumps which are within in one housing, and each pump will be connected to one individual nozzle. So this configuration is also there. So this is unit injector. So this unit injector, I just said, so you could either have, if you have the fuel pump and fuel injector in the same configuration, then you have this unit injector system. If you have them in separate bodies connected by high pressure pipeline, then you have this configuration. Okay, or you can have a system where you have a common rail CRDI kind of a system, or distributor pump system, where you have just one pump and that is supplying the fuel to all the nozzles in individual cylinders. In CRDI system, you have one single pump, but then that single pump is supplying the fuel to a high pressure storage system, which is called fuel accumulator or fuel rail. And from that fuel rail, different individual nozzles are connected. Okay. So this is basically different types of configurations that are possible as far as the combination of fuel pump and fuel injectors for injection systems are concerned. Now, if you look at the electronic control of the engines, when an engine is tested, the power output is tested, emissions, manifold vacuum, optimum ignition timing, and air fuel mixture. This is all important, these are all important parameters, and they have to be recorded for each throttle setting. That means for each load and speed combinations, you have to optimize these. What is the power output? What is the emission level? What is the pressure, manifold pressure depression? How much is the vacuum that you are creating in the intake manifold? What is the optimum timing? What is the air fuel mixture? So basically, for each throttle condition, each load and speed combination, you measure it, okay? And then you vary these parameters and choose what is optimum. And then you plot these kind of curves. For example, this is engine speed versus BMEP, brake mean specific pressure, BMEP. And then you see there are three parameters that are shown here. One is the specific fuel consumption, SFC. These are the SFC curves, solid lines, okay? And this dotted line is pressure drop across the throttle. So that is the vacuum that you are creating across the throttle in the manifold. So these are the throttles. And this top line is wide open throttle. So wide open throttle means you pull the full throttle and see what kind of BMEP you can generate, maximum BMEP that you can generate at different speeds, okay? So this is a typical example. All this information is then used by the EMS to control the ignition timing and exhaust gas recirculation valve and fuel injection equipment. So basically you create these kind of maps and optimize the values for each load and speed combinations, each demand, and then build those maps in the ECU. So whenever it senses a particular speed and load, the ECU then refers the values that are stored, picks up the optimum value, and then actuates the injectors. That's all. So in a simple term. So in the EMS, some of these parameters can be measured. For example, specific fuel consumption is a parameter that is very important and we can easily measure. So for the measurement of specific fuel consumption, you have to just find out the fuel consumption and how much power you're generating. So per kilowatt hour, how much fuel is being consumed per hour, that's the specific fuel consumption. Similarly, you can measure the pressure drop across the throttle and wide open throttle. So you can create a graph which is called engine map, okay? So coming to the fuel pump, the objective is to deliver the accurately the metered quantity, whatever quantity you want to inject in the cylinder, that it is going to meter. And then high pressure is also generated in the fuel pump depending on the compression ratio of the engine to achieve the required atomization of the fuel. Higher is the compression ratio, more will be the pressure inside the combustion chamber. So obviously you will need then higher pressure to inject the fuel, okay? So fuel must be injected and terminated at the correct time. So start of injection and end of the injection, both have to be absolutely crisp and absolutely controlled, okay? So this is just an example of inline fuel pump, okay? So this is the cam, you can see here the cam. So, and then fuel is coming in, and here is a rack, okay? So when this fuel cam pushes this, the fuel is pushed out, and there is a spring-loaded valve here, delivery valve. So whenever sufficient pressure is created, the fuel is allowed to go out to the injector, okay? So this is in simple terms what how an inline fuel injection pump looks like. And this is just one type. There are many other types of fuel pumps, okay? There could be rotary pump, there could be CRDI pumps, etc., etc. So this is an example of rotary pump. So here you see there is only one delivery port, okay? And then, you know, this rotates, this is connected to the crankshaft and pressurizes and gives this fuel to different cylinders. So only one pump which is pressurizing and only one same quantity of the fuel is given to different cylinders because there is only one rotating element, okay? This type of pump is very compact and cheap compared to inline pumps, and therefore, you know, this is very popular. So compared to inline pumps, this is quite popular. I don't want to really go into details because this is really the first level course. I just want to introduce you to the technology in a very high level. Similarly, this is Bosch fuel injection pump. Again, in simple terms, you know, you can look at this. This is camshaft. This is the follower. So when this pushes, this is pushing against the springs, okay? So when the cam is on its base circle, these springs will expand and keep these two, cam and follower, in contact. And this is the plunger rack. So how much quantity of fuel will be injected? This depends on what is the position of this rack. Okay. And this is, there is a helical groove here. Okay. So depending on the helical groove, it, whatever quantity is contained in that is injected. So when you want maximum fuel, high load conditions, all this fuel that will be stored here will be injected. When you want low load conditions, this will rotate because it's like this, this is the central spindle and there is a helical groove here and there is a rack here. So when you move the rack, this is going to change. Okay. So depending on the rotation, the quantity of fuel that will be injected will be actually controlled. Okay. So it consists of a barrel in which a plunger reciprocates. So this is the plunger that is reciprocating, which is driven by a camshaft. The plunger has a constant stroke. So stroke length is always constant because the cam design is fixed. So if you have to vary the quantity, you have to vary the orientation of this barrel. The pump barrel and the plunger have in between them a very small clearance. Usually the clearance is very, very small, 2 to 3 thousandth of a millimeter. Okay. So the clearance is only enough to allow the movement but not to allow the leakage of the fuel through it. Okay. The pump barrel has two radially opposing holes. These are inlet and control ports. So there is one inlet port here, there is one spill port here. Okay. So in order to vary the quantity of the fuel developed per stroke, a vertical channel extending from the top face of the plunger to annular groove is provided. So you see here, this is the vertical groove in the plunger. Okay. So the upper end is called control edge. This is called control edge. Okay. So depending on where it is rotated, inlet port will allow the fuel to be filled here. So the fuel will be filled and this will be filled. When you compress it, first the inlet port will be covered. Actually, this is not really an absolutely correct picture. This spill port should be slightly above. Okay, so first the inlet ports get covered and then, you know, the compression will happen and the fuel will be injected. Now if you want to have a smaller quantity of injection, then what you do, you rotate this, and when you rotate this, this portion, suppose this portion comes in front of this, so obviously the remaining fuel will pass through the spill port and not be injected. So that's how you control the quantity of fuel injection. It is more clear here. You can see this is the inlet port, this is the spill port. Okay. And then you see here, so when you are compressing, you know, the effective stroke will be up to here. This is this port, this will keep on injecting unless this port comes in. And this start talking. So when this and this moves up, the C position, all the fuel will be going back. Okay, so only this quantity will be injected. Suppose you move, and when you move, you bring it like this. Now C is here. So only small quantity will be injected, and this part will be now uncovered. So only a smaller quantity will be injected. So that's how the quantity control in the fuel injection pump is actually done. Okay, using the helical groove. And in fact, we'll be happy to show you this in dismantled form. Okay. So this is as far as the fuel pump is concerned. Here again, you have a spring loaded valve and you will have a high pressure pipeline, and that high pressure pipeline will be connected to the injector, and then finally the injector will have nozzles. Okay. So that's where high pressure fuel will reach. And as I said, the nozzles are very, very small. This is of the order of 120, 150 micron kind of a hole. So nozzle is a small part of the injector through which fuel is injected into the combustion chamber. Design of the nozzle should be such that the liquid fuel leaving the nozzle is atomized. So it has to disintegrate into very small droplets. Okay. And that will help in proper mixing, adequate mixing of fuel with the air. So the nozzles that are used in injector, depending on the combustion chamber used in the engines, various types of nozzles are used. One is the pintle nozzle, then single hole nozzle, then multi hole nozzles, and pintox nozzle. Okay. So I'll show you some of the example. This is a pintle nozzle. So one of the easiest way to actually identify the pintle nozzle is that it has a small pin. So when you touch the end, you will feel that there is a small pin popping out from the end. So this is that pin. So here the pressurized fuel comes in. So in the initial phase, you know, this edge will be sitting here and this pin will be actually popping out. Okay. So there is a spring force that keeps this closed. So when the pressure is applied and high enough, this pressure is going to push this up against the force of spring, and when you have sufficient pressure, this will lift. Okay. And once this lifts, there will be some kind of annular hole that will be created, because in the center you have the pin and the fuel will start popping out. Okay. So this have thin ends to form the pin. Shape of the pin can be varied, hollow cylindrical jet and a wide spray angle can be obtained. So this is a hollow cone. So inside there will be air and there will be some kind of a conical spray will come out, and you will have really wide angle, and depending on what is the angle here, you can actually control how wide spray you would like to have. Okay. So the good part is that it avoids the dribbling of the fuel in the combustion chamber. So dribbling of the fuel is the last big droplets that are going and which are creating pollution. So you don't have much dribbling in case of pintle nozzle. This is single nozzle hole geometry. So single hole nozzle geometry, you can see this doesn't pop out. Similar configuration is pintle, but there is no way this is going to come out. Okay. So this will sit here, a single hole at the bottom, and you can see this is the nozzle here. This is the nozzle hole. So the hole diameter here in this case is quite large. It's about 200 microns. Okay. The spray cone angle can be varied from 5 to 20 degrees. So a single hole is not really very large spray angle, and this is suitable for open combustion chamber. Okay. Open combustion chamber we had discussed, right? And the disadvantage are it gives small spray cone angle and it has a tendency to dribble, because there will be lot of fuel which will be contained in here. So even when you have closed this, there will be this part which will be containing the some fuel will be left, and when the heating takes place, this fuel will expand and detach itself and come into the combustion chamber, and this small droplet, you know, is going to create give you a lot of fuel penalty and also lot of emissions, particulate emissions particularly. In multiple nozzles, this is multiple hole nozzle is very, very popular, and this is also similar. You see, this is the shaft or spindle of the injector, and here the pressure is coming, and this pressure is going to apply the force here, and this will be lifted. But in the bottom, you can see that there are many holes. Okay, there will be some kind of this kind of geometry, and there will be many holes, and these holes could be very, very small. The number of holes can vary depending on what is the application. This could be 4, 6, 8, 3, 12, depending on, you know, what kind of, what size of the engine you are dealing with. For example, if you are dealing with a ship engine of 900 millimeter diameter, then probably you will have 12 holes, nozzle, multi-hole nozzles. Okay. Small engine could have 3 or 4 holes. Okay. So the diameter of the nozzle holes could be about 120 micron to about 150, 200 micron. Okay. The advantage is that it ensures proper mixing of the fuel in the combustion chamber, because there are multiple holes, and through these multiple holes, a lot of fuel is going to come in, and it is going to utilize the entire air that is available in the clearance volume or at the end of the compression stroke. Okay. So the disadvantage is that it requires high injection pressure, because the fuel is leaking from many holes. So if you really go for small pressure, the droplets will be very large. So you have to actually go for much higher pressure. So 200 to 2000 bar, depending on what is your requirement and application. So this multi-hole nozzle requires much higher pressure. Then you have this Pintox nozzle. Okay. And this Pintox nozzle is also a pintle type nozzle, but there is an auxiliary hole drilled in it. So there is one extra hole drilled in it. Auxiliary hole injects the fuel in a direction upstream, the direction of air before main injection starts. So basically, you see what will happen is that first, you know, the auxiliary hole will start injecting some small amount of fuel, and then the main hole will start injecting the holes. So it reduces the delay period, because, you know, the some small fuel has been injected first, so it will warm up, it will burn first, and once it burns first, it's a small quantity, but it will warm the environment for the main fuel to come in. So when the main fuel is injected at that time, it will encounter hotter air and high pressure air because of the combustion that has happened because of the auxiliary air. So what will happen? It will reduce the delay period and combustion will be more smoother, and therefore the combustion noise that you have will be less. So this engine is expected to be much more quieter, okay, and this is one of the very good ways of suppression of noise from the engine, noise and vibrations also. So it results in better cold starting performance and basically more silent engine development. So these are the four different types of nozzles which are used in diesel fuel injection, okay. So let us now look at what are the effects of different variables on spark ignition and compression ignition engine, combustion performance, emissions, etc. So I will discuss about different type of engine efficiencies, we will discuss some performance characteristic curves, then we will discuss the variables which affects the engine performance. There are many variables which affect the engine performance. For example, what is the rate of heat release, which is also called combustion rate, what is the spark timing, it is also going to affect the engine performance, air fuel ratio, compression ratio, engine speed, what is the mass of the inducted fuel air mixture, and what are the heat losses. All these are the parameters which affect the engine performance, and we will discuss them one by one. Then we will also look at methods of improving engine performance. Can we really improve the engine performance? And then we will look at some of the heat balance for an engine and look at some of the performance maps, okay. So for different applications of IC engine, the performance depends on interrelationship between how much is the power developed, what is the speed, and what is the brake specific fuel consumption at each operating speed and load, and that is what we try to optimize always, okay. We try to increase the power output, we try to increase the speed or reduce the speed, and we definitely try to reduce the specific emissions. Then you could add, you know, some other parameters. For example, in modern context, you know, emissions are also very important, emissions of carbon monoxide, emissions of hydrocarbons, emissions of NOx, emissions of particulates. These are extremely important because unless and until you have them under control as specified by the emission norms, you will not be able to sell the product in the market. So they are also extremely important, okay. So performance characteristics and emission characteristics are extremely important. So the important factors to be considered for evaluation of any engine performance is, so you would like to have, you know, you would like to know what is the maximum torque at each load and speed combination, and you would like to increase that value so that engine develops more power. What is the range of power at a constant speed for stable operation, okay. So at a given speed, what is the range of power that you can generate? So basically at a given speed, what is the torque you can generate? P equal to 2 pi nt. So if you want to look at, if you fix the n, so range of power means range of torque, right? T is directly going to be proportional to P that you generate. So brake specific fuel consumption at every condition is also of great importance to the users, and also, you know, reliability and durability of the engine in the entire operating range is also extremely critical. So these are the performance evaluation parameters on which the performance of a given engine for a particular application needs to be evaluated, okay. So engine power, as we know, engine power is generally of two types. One is the indicated power, the other one is brake power. What is the difference? Indicated power is the power which is transferred by the combustion gases to the piston, and brake power is what we are drawing from the shaft. In between, there is a lot of friction, okay. So there is indicated power, there is brake power, and in between, you know, whatever power is being lost, that is called frictional power, right. So the mean effective pressure similarly is divided into two, actually. So if you calculate the mean effective pressure at the piston end, then it is called indicated mean effective pressure. If you calculate the indicated at the brake end or shaft end, then it is called brake mean effective pressure or BMEP, and whatever is lost in the friction and unaccounted losses, that is called frictional mean effective power or FMEP. So IMEP, IP indicated power, is equal to brake power plus frictional power. Similarly, IMEP is equal to BMEP plus FMEP. So that's pretty simple. I think we have discussed air standard efficiency when we discussed the air standard cycles, but just for a recap, you know, air standard efficiency is also known as thermodynamic efficiency. This is the maximum gold standard that you can target in ideal conditions, never happens. So it's mainly a function of compression ratio, and given the upper limit, this gives the upper limit of the efficiency that you can obtain from a given engine, which can never be obtained in real life, okay. But that's the target for the engine designer. Air standard efficiency is the target. You would like to design and make improvements such that you reach as close as possible to the air standard. That's the target, okay. Just like auto cycle efficiency, okay. So it is the ideal efficiency of an engine. The fuel and air mixture is assumed to be just air. We don't consider fuel in air standard efficiency, right? So fuel vapors are not really considered. So in addition, there are many other assumptions when we do calculate the air standard efficiency. What were the assumptions? First is that air standard efficiency does not take into account heat transfer from the engine. In real life, a lot of energy is wasted in heat transfer. Then in air standard cycle, we assume that, you know, combustion is instantaneous and combustion is complete. In real life, combustion is never complete 100%. And it is never instantaneous. It's a process that takes time. It's not instantaneous, okay? And it also assumes that the heat is added when the volume is minimum. In real life, that never happens. So it assumes that there is no volume change during combustion. But in real life, it does take place, okay? In real life, the volume always changes, okay? So, and then, you know, it assumes the specific heat capacity, MCP, of the air to be constant. In real life, CP changes with temperature. So all these factors which are not accounted for in air standard cycle are the reasons why your actual efficiency is lower than air standard efficiency. That's why this is theoretical, and that is practical efficiency that you can get. Now coming to indicated thermal efficiency, with that background, indicated thermal efficiency is the based on the indicated power of the engine, okay? And this basically tells you how much power is being transferred by the burning gases to the first linkage. What is the first linkage? First interface, it's the piston, because that's moving, cylinder head etc. is not moving. So whatever power is being transferred by the gases to the piston, that is a reflective of indicated power. So it gives an idea of maximum output that can be generated with respect to heat supplied by the fuel, which ultimately gets transferred to combustion gases that are expanding. So in a typical SI engine, the indicated thermal efficiency is of the order of 28% to 30%. And typical CI engine, the IMEP is of the order of 38% to 40%. Why this difference? Because the SI engines have lower compression ratio, CI engines have higher compression ratio. So indicated efficiency, Nita ITH, is indicated power upon energy that is put in. Power divided by energy. So this is indicated power, and what is the energy that you put in? Mass of the fuel per second into calorific value of the fuel, and that's how you will calculate the IMEP. Sorry, IP, ITE. Your so BT, brake thermal efficiency. So I told you in one of my earlier lectures, what is the definition of efficiency? definition of efficiency in real term was what you desire divided by what you give. So what you desire is indicated power, and what you give is the amount of fuel that you are putting, right? Similarly, if you define the brake thermal efficiency, it is based on the brake power. So it is really the power that you are getting at the shaft end. Okay, it gives an idea of actual output that can be generated with respect to the heat supplied. So the definition of BMEP therefore is brake power. Instead, IP changes to brake power now, and this is MF into CV. CV is the calorific value, and obviously the CV is what? Lower calorific value or higher calorific value? It's always, in case of IC engine, it's always lower calorific value, and MF is basically mass flow rate of the fuel. Okay, so the difference between air standard cycle efficiency, thermal indicated thermal efficiency, and brake thermal efficiency must be absolutely clear to you. So air standard efficiency is the highest that we try to obtain. Indicated thermal efficiency is what you have at the piston interface, piston interface, okay, and then brake thermal efficiency is what really is available to do actual work. So the most important for you is brake thermal efficiency, because that tells you how much power will be available for you for a given application, whether it is automotive application or for power generation or for irrigation or whatever. Okay, then you see there is something called mechanical efficiency, and mechanical efficiency, I have told you that when the power is given to the piston and from there it travels and it undergoes a lot of friction, and then there is some power that is available at the shaft end. So if there is too much of heat loss, so too much of friction and unaccounted losses, then less power will be available for you at the shaft end. So mechanical efficiency actually tells what is the power that is available at the shaft end divided by what is the power being given. So how much is the, it gives you an idea about how much power is being lost in the mechanical system. Okay, so it takes into account all the mechanical losses that are taking place inside the engine, and there could be many sources of losses, mechanical losses in the engine. Typical losses, of course, one is the frictional loss. So frictional loss, about half of the mechanical loss is frictional loss, and where are the frictional losses taking place? So there is a piston ring that is rubbing all the time against the liner, and liner is rough, so there is a lot of friction. So 50% of those mechanical losses are at that interface. Okay, and then you have a lot of bearings, so bearings also are not frictionless, they always have friction. And then you have valves opening and closing, so all these actually you require power to operate all these, and they contribute to friction. So the loss of power due to friction in components like piston, bearing, gears, valves, and this is about 7 to 9% of the indicated power output. Okay, so about mechanical efficiency is 85%, roughly around 85%. So that means 15% is lost, and out of those 15%, 7 to 8% is lost here, almost half is lost in the friction. And then you have many auxiliary systems which require power. For example, fuel pump, you have to operate the fuel pump. The oil pump, you have to operate the oil pump. So components like fuel pump, lubricating oil pump, water circulating pump, radiator, magneto, alternator, all these also drain power, which is not being which is not contributing to the useful power in the shaft, right? So they also absorb a lot of energy, and this accounts for 3 to 8% of the indicated power. Then you have ventilation action of the flywheel. You must have seen that when you go close to the engine, flywheel also has some kind of spokes which actually agitate the air. Why they agitate the air? You deliberately do it so that it throws the air on the engine outside, so that the engine temperature can be cooled. Okay, so obviously when you are making some kind of extra intrusions or splines on the flywheel, it is going to experience aerodynamic drag, which will require power to overcome, right? So this actually consumes about 3 to 4% of the indicated power output. A lot of power is wasted for the ventilation action of the flywheel. And then you see what happens is that the intake that you are taking in. So intake, you know, you have to create suction and you require some power for it. Exhaust stroke, you know, you have to push the gases out. So that also contributes to loss, you know, you have to take in, you have to push out. So this also contributes. So mechanical efficiency of engine therefore is about 65% to 85%. Most modern engines have mechanical efficiency of the order of 80-85%. 65% means you have really done a bad job with the engine design, okay. So most of the engines nowadays have about 80-85% mechanical efficiency. Now relative efficiency. So relative efficiency is the basically the actual efficiency of the engine to the theoretical efficiency. So actual efficiency is what? What is the actual efficiency of the engine? Brake thermal efficiency. And what is the ideal efficiency? Air standard. So relative efficiency is actual brake thermal efficiency divided by air standard efficiency. So in a typical IC engine, this varies from 75% to 95%. Actually 95% is highly unlikely, but 75% is what is more likely. 75-80%, okay. Now the next important definition of efficiency is volumetric efficiency. So volumetric efficiency actually tells you how efficiently the air is inducted in the engine combustion chamber, okay. So air or charge is inducted inside the combustion chamber and it indicates the breathing capacity of the engine, how efficiently your engine breathes in the air, okay. So obviously, I mean, engine is just like if we compare with human beings, right? And if you take slow breathe, you can take in more amount of air, right? And you start doing, you know, Baba Ramdev kind of thing, then obviously you're doing everything fast and then you don't fill your lungs enough. So in that case, the mass of the air that goes in also reduces. So in a way, just if you look at the engine comparison or engine parallel, if you are operating an engine at slow speed, it will have better volumetric efficiency. If the same engine, when you operate at fast speed, obviously its volumetric efficiency will go down. So volumetric efficiency for an engine is not fixed. It depends on what speed you are operating, right? And how do we calculate? So calculation is very simple. It says it's the ratio of the actual mass of air, not volume of the air. Mass of the air drawn in engine during a given period divided by the theoretical mass that should have been drawn. So how do you calculate theoretical mass? You will take the swept volume, you will take the density of the air, and that will tell you how much mass of the air you are putting in every stroke, okay. And actual that you take in, so you will measure the actual mass flow rate divided by how many times the intake stroke is, and that will tell you actual, and it will always be lower, okay. It will always be lower. So the theoretical mass is computed from the geometry of the engine cylinder, number of cylinders and speed of the engine, and actual air is actually measured using appropriate instrumentation of the engine, okay. Yeah. Volumetric efficiency will go more than one, obviously, and that's the reason. I mean, efficiency can never be one in some sense, but it is always, I mean, you say it is more than one. In this we accept more than one. When we say turbocharged engine, so we say that the volumetric efficiency is 110%. So the amount of mass that is taken in actual with turbocharger divided by what it could theoretically take in a naturally aspirated condition. So it's not a fair comparison, but that's the tradition, okay. Coming to the combustion efficiency, this is another type of efficiency that is important from engine point of view. So combustion efficiency basically tells you have put in some amount of fuel. Does it burn completely and release all the heat? It does not. Why it does not? Because there may be some fuel that may be going as unburnt hydrocarbon, some fuel may be going out as carbon monoxide, some fuel may be going out as particulate matter, some fuel may be going out as unburnt fuel, some fuel may be finding its way through the rings into the oil sump and going out as blow-by losses. So fuel is lost. So whatever is burning, whatever energy is being released, divided by whatever energy you are putting in the fuel, that gives you the combustion efficiency of the fuel. So combustion efficiency is the ratio of heat liberated to the theoretical heat in the fuel. Theoretical heat is MF into CV, right? So the amount of heat liberated is always less than the theoretical value, either due to dissociation or incomplete combustion. Okay, and basically if you look at the SI engines, the typical SI engine, if you get 95% combustion efficiency, you should be happy about it. You have made a good engine. But if you are looking at a diesel engine, you are looking at 98 to 98.5% combustion efficiency. Even the worst engine where a lot of black smoke is coming out, I'm telling you the efficiency for the worst diesel combustion engine will still be 98%. Okay, and the best SI engine will always be 95%. Okay. Now if you look at the engine performance characteristics, you know why they are important, because this is a convenient way of graphically representing the engine performance. So we present the engine performance by some graphs. It is constructed from the data obtained by testing. So you have to conduct performance test and plot it, and those are called performance characteristics. It's particularly used for comparison between two different engines. For example, if you have made a 100cc engine and you have made a half a liter engine and you want to compare them, he says that his engine is better and he says his engine is better. How do you compare? You cannot put them to race because they are different size and capacity. Okay, so basically then what you do is you test them independently, you prepare performance characteristics of his engine and his engine, and then plot them on the same curve to see which engine is performing better. Okay, so basically if you are comparing two different engines of the same size or different size, you can compare them by performance characteristics. The performance parameters are plotted at different engine operating conditions. Okay, for example, this is a typical engine performance characteristics. So within the speed range of the engine, there is a specific speed at which charge inducted is maximum. And at that point, the maximum torque is also experienced. So you see here, this is the air charge inducted per cylinder. Okay? So obviously, when the engine is at low speed, you will be inducting less because the number of filling and emptying cycles is low, right? As you keep on increasing, this will keep on increasing. But then comes a point where if you increase the speed, the air inducted will start decreasing. Why it will start decreasing? Because now with increasing speed, your volumetric efficiency has started going down. You are not able to fill the engine cylinder properly, and more you go, more volumetric efficiency reduction will take place, and therefore the air charge that you are inducting will also start falling. Okay, and here you see obviously if you are taking more charge, you are able to put more amount of fuel, and therefore you will be able to generate torque. So the air charge inducted and torque indicated, torque generated, they will be following each other. Now this is the air consumption curve. Sorry, this is the indicated power curve. Okay, and this is the speed for maximum torque. This is the speed for maximum indicated power. This indicated power keep on increasing, and it will go, because what is indicated power? What is the formula for the power? Power, the formula is P equal to 2 pi NT. So that means speed and torque both have to be multiplied. So speed is increasing, so first here, you know, speed is increasing, torque is increasing, so it is also going to increase. Then this is falling at some rate, but this speed is increasing, so you multiply it. So this will keep on increasing, at some point IP will be maximum and then will start falling. Okay, so this is the speed for maximum indicated power. Okay, yep. Air charge basically is the air fuel mixture. So as the speed is further increased, the quantity of charge will decrease. However, power output does not decrease due to higher number of cycles being executed. As I said, P equal to 2 pi NT. So, engines are designed such a way that maximum air consumption is reached outside the operating range of the engine. Now, if you look at this, this is the torque curve, okay? This is the IP curve, okay? Now, you see, when the engine is rotated fast, what will happen to the frictional losses? They will increase, and higher is the power, the increase rate of increase will also increase. So, if you look at the frictional power is increasing, but as you are increasing higher, this slope will also increase. So, obviously, what will happen to the brake power? Now, this is IP curve, this is the frictional power curve. So, the BP curve will be like this, and this is what is available to you, okay? So, BP curve, brake power output curve for most engines maximizes at about 70-75% of the rated speed. So, at lower speeds the frictional power is low, hence brake power is equal to indicated power. So, this is the difference is not much here because this is still manageable. With increase in speed, frictional power increases at a faster rate, and therefore the difference between these two curves actually increases. Now, this is the torque and this is the indicated power. What will happen? The next parameter that you are interested in, what is the fuel economy? So, fuel economy, how do you define? Fuel economy is the fuel consumed divided by the power that you are generating. So, if you look at the fuel consumption, this is the fuel consumption. So, as you will keep on increasing the throttle, more and more fuel will be consumed and more power will be generated. When you divide this, the specific fuel consumption, that means kilograms of fuel per kilowatt of power generated will be like this. So, in the beginning, you are not generating much of useful power, right? Here you see in the beginning, you are not generating much of IP. So, specific fuel consumption is higher. As you keep on increasing the speed, BSFC starts coming down because you are generating more and more power. And then at some point, this will be low, and then again, you know, the fuel consumption will start going up. And the reason for this is that, you know, there is lot of fuel that is wasted in frictional power, and that is why the BSFC again start rising, okay. So, the quantity of fuel consumption will increase with engine speed, this continuously increases, but when you divide it by power output, this is the curve that you get. The BSFC drops with the speed in low speed ranges, levels out in the middle range, and then again increases in the high speed range. So, that's the trend for brake specific fuel consumption or the fuel economy. Okay. So, at low speeds also you see the heat loss to the combustion chamber walls is greater. So, at low speeds, you know, because at if you look at this, at low speeds you are generating very small useful power, but there is comparatively there is larger fraction of the fuel going to be lost as a heat through the cylinder walls in the fraction, okay. And combustion efficiency is also poor, and hence the BSFC drops. The curve is plotted for full throttle. So, these are all curves which are plotted for full throttle operation. If the throttle and hence the load is varied at constant speed, suppose you want to maintain the speed. See, just to avoid any confusion, I would just like to mention here that whenever we test the engine, we do not vary the speed and torque, okay, simultaneously. So, either we fix the engine load or engine torque and then vary the speed, or we fix the engine speed, vary the torque. So, in this case, what we have done is we have kept the speed constant, n equal to constant, and then change the engine load from 0% to 100%. So you can see that BSFC will rise with decrease in load. So as you keep on going in this direction, reduce the load, BSFC will rise. Okay. So the frictional power remains constant. Why this trend is completely opposite to what we discussed earlier is that we are maintaining the speed constant. Since we are maintaining the speed constant, whether it is full load or no load, frictional losses will be same because speed is same. Okay. That is why at low load conditions you have higher BSFC, because lot of energy in relative terms is being used to overcome the friction. Does that make sense? So the frictional power remains constant, frictional losses remains constant, but indicated power decreases, hence the brake power also decreases. A general performance curve is shown, is often constructed and provided by the manufacturer. This curve is provided for full throttle operation. So full throttle means you pull the throttle and then just vary the speed. Okay. So when you vary the speed, you know, the torque characteristics will be like this, brake power will be like this, and specific fuel consumption will be like this. And if you buy a particular engine from a particular manufacturer, that manufacturer is obliged to give you this information so that you know exactly what is the performance of your curve, performance of the engine device that you have bought. Okay. If you look at the CI engine performance, so CI engine performance is slightly different. So you see here, this is direct injection diesel engine and this is the IDI engine. So let's first focus on DI engine. Okay. So if you look at the DI engine, so obviously when you are increasing the engine speed, the indicated power is going to go up. Okay. And as you increase the speed, the FMEP will also go up. So BP will be following the similar curve as we have seen in the SI engine case also, and this will be IMEP and this will be BMEP. Okay. And this will be the curve for BSFC and this will be curve for ISFC. So tell me, you know, which is this correct? BSFC will be higher or ISFC will be higher? Brake specific fuel consumption should be higher or indicated fuel consumption should be higher? Brake should be higher because lot of fuel that you have put in has gone into overcoming the friction. Similarly, if you look at IDI engine, you see in IDI engine there is a lot of difference between BMEP and IMEP because there is a lot of heat loss. Heat loss is much higher in case of IDI engines because there is a pre-chamber and swill chamber, there is higher surface area. So the difference between these two curves is larger because of the heat losses. And here you see this will be also more wider. Higher speed you go, more heat will be lost and therefore this will be wider. So you can see that there is slight difference between DI engine performance characteristics and IDI engine performance characteristics. So for naturally aspirated DI and IDI engines, brake torque and mean effective pressure, they vary modestly with the speed. The intake system of the CI engine can have more flow area than that of SI engine. Why? Because SI engine is throttled and CI engine is not throttled. So that's why the flow area will be large. The part load curves have a similar shape for as that of full load curves.